Chilled Show. I'm Mike Papantonio in for Ed. The gap between the haves and have-nots, it continues to grow at an alarming rate in America. And as a result, our country is creeping closer and closer to becoming a full-blown plutocracy. Joining me to talk about that is Howard Nations. He's the past president of the National Trial Lawyers Association. And I just have to tell you, one of the finest trial lawyers probably in the country. Howard, I want to, you know, before you came on, I had a very interesting caller that was amazed at the fact that we still have an oil industry that's willing to basically destroy the planet. They know the truth. They understand that they're going to damage the lives of the next generation, the generation after that. They know that they're trying to squeeze the last little bit out of the ground any way they can. In Florida, as a matter of fact, we learn now fracking. There's going to be movement to frack in Florida, one of the biggest natural aquifers in the country, one of them. And so we have these people. And Howard, it's amazing to me when I do this show sometimes, and I've been doing, as you know, radio for a long time. But I still hear people that just, they're surprised when I say to them that we're dealing sometimes with psychopaths dressed up in Armani suits. Now, I know this because you and I have been involved in the same cases. I've seen you taking the deposition of somebody who looks like they talk like Mother Teresa, but they have the heart of Hannibal Lecter. And you understand that as you're taking the deposition. But sometimes it's so hard for the American public to believe that that's where we've gotten. You and I just handled a case where the company calculated how many people they could kill, how many people could they kill, and still make a profit by simply paying off the people after the case was over, by selling pharmaceuticals. I mean, the real true-to-life calculation. What is your take on that before we move into that? Because this is part of the argument about plutocracy. When you have people so rich and so wealthy and so such an elite that they just have such disdain for decency and the way we treat each other, you see that day to day and have for 40 years practicing law as one of the best trial lawyers in this country. What's your take?
My take on it, Mike, is that it's all part of the measuring stick of plutocracy. Plutocracy is measured... Everything is measured by wealth. Everything else steps aside. You push aside all the other principles to get to wealth. And the plutocrats have their own golden rule. He who has the gold makes the rules. And so they will do whatever it takes, and they will damage as many people as it takes. They will harm as much of society. They will harm the planet. They will harm the environment. They will harm the individual citizens in the interest of profit.
Now, that's coming, just for the listeners, understand. I think probably you've been involved in some of the biggest cases in the country for 40 years in trials where you've confronted these people. I mean, absolutely. I go home sometimes and I tell my wife and I tell my child, I confronted raw, ugly evil today in a deposition or in a courtroom. And, you know, until they started coming and seeing it, it's hard to believe, and it's very difficult for the average person out there just listening to this broadcast to believe that it's gotten that bad. But it all does deal with the rule of law according to wealth. And where are we with that in the United States today? Well, describe the rule of wealth in the United States number-wise.
Well, in the United States, we have seen a major upheaval in the last 40 years. If we look at the time frame since 1973, this is an amazing statistic. While the gross domestic product of the country as a whole has doubled, more than doubled, since 1973, 80% of the national wealth in that 40-year period has gone to the upper 2% of the population. 65% has gone to that upper 1% that we heard so much about. But when you get to the part that really matters, and this is a shocking statistic, between 2000 and 2012, the real net worth of 90% of Americans has declined by 25%. That's just an absolutely amazing statistic.
It's incredible. I mean, well, what's happened, because we've had dismantling of regulations and financial activities, we've had predatory extraction of money from the system. You go back all the way to we don't have enough time on the show to talk about the damage Ronald Reagan did, but Bill Clinton, I mean, you know, tax reform since 1990s, lacks application to anybody with wealth, more application to people who simply don't matter, to the IRS, you know. Eric Holder, prosecutions, where he says that any kind of prosecution of wealthy banks is going to cause economic disaster. No numbers to show that. He simply says it. Aren't these things that all double the standard between the haves and the have-nots in a plutocracy, which is what we would expect, isn't it?
It is what we would expect. And, you know, the point about Eric Holder, he actually made the statement recently that when he, as head of the Justice Department, makes a decision as to whether to bring criminal charges against the biggest financial institutions in the world, actually, that those decisions will depend not on a question of whether they violated the law alone, but would include the hypothetical effects on economic stability. So he's come up with a whole new concept. We heard a lot about too big to fail. We now have the concept from the Attorney General of the United States that they're too big to prosecute, because if we prosecute them, it might hurt the economy.
Isn't that the very definition of plutocracy? Absolutely. Isn't that the heart of it? Look, we're living in a time when these very people that we won't prosecute. I don't know if you saw the Levin committee hearings where they were, you know, the committee was about the London Whale, who had stolen so much money from the system. And we, at the end of the committee meeting, it was just, we'll ignore what happened. And you actually had people in those hearings calling regulators stupid to their face because they had so much money that they had disdain for government policy. They had disdain for the people who were even questioning them. They were above the law of the senators that show. Matter of fact, with the London Whale case, larceny, fraud was involved, bribery was involved. Only three senators even showed up for that hearing. Because when you really come right down to it, we have a plutocracy that's able to ignore the EPA. They ignore the FDA. They ignore the IRS. They ignore the rules of government contracts. And that's what plutocracy does. It turns the democratic process upside down on its head. Isn't that where we're living right now, Howard?
Well, that is where we're living. For example, in the 2003 Medicare bill, the pharmaceutical companies had a provision put into the 2003 Medicare Act that said that the federal government, the largest purchaser between all the drugs that the government buys, that for Medicare, Medicaid, the military, and so forth, the bill actually says that the U.S. government shall not negotiate the price of those drugs with the pharmaceutical companies.
Yeah.
That's absolutely astounding.
Look, you have. I want to get your take on something. You're somebody who raised huge money for Obama. You worked for him tirelessly. You've met with him. You've talked to him. You've been face to face with him. What is your take? Is there any difference in the way that Obama has reacted to plutocracy, and any other president that's come before him just in recent decades?
Well, I think that Bill Clinton, with whom I talked a lot before he became president, and Obama both went into office with the best of intentions. I think that they went into office with the idea that we're going to represent the best interest of the American public, the citizens, the middle class that President Obama was talking about so much in his reelection campaign. But the fact of the matter is that when they get in there and they find out who really runs the system, this is government of the rich, by the rich, for the rich. And when they get in, they end up putting the same people in office to run the Treasury, to run the moneyed interest.
Well, look at this administration, surrounded by Bill Rubin, Paulson, Geithner, Summers, that they're relying on Erskine Bowles, of all people, to sell this fraudulent austerity argument that we have to cut the elderly's Social Security and the elderly's in disabled Medicare because austerity is going to save us. And then we find out that Erskine Bowles even lied to us about that. That he actually lied to us about the statistics he was relying on because they were phonied up. And we don't even learn that from corporate media, because corporate media is part of the problem too. We learn it because you have an independent investigator that goes and looks at the numbers and says, this is all a lie. And when he calls it to their attention, they admit, yeah, it was a lie. I mean, how upside down do we get before there's just absolute just rejection of the system totally? When do we get there?
We should be there now. The fact of the matter is people like Erskine Bowles are relying on, quote, think tank, end quote, studies. But the think tanks depend on corporate money. So they come out with their own studies that support their propositions, their whole austerity thing. And then people like Bowles are appointed by the president, and then they're cited and they rely upon him. Rubin, who was appointed by President Clinton originally.
Chairman of Citibank.
He left there and he oversaw the deregulation while he was Secretary of the Treasury. He deregulated Wall Street.
While he was there to supposedly to oversee them.